I heard of that Jim Crow South, but I didn't have any firsthand knowledge of what it actually was about until I transferred from Howard University to Fisk University. It's in Nashville, Tennessee. I got a quick education. I was slapped in the face at every turn with whites only signs all over the city. Obeying those signs made me feel like I agree with them that I was inferior. I wasn't about to accept or submit to that foolishness. I knew then a change had to be made. In 1959, Reverend James Lawson taught tactical workshops on nonviolent techniques. I attended a few of them. It was 1960, and I was young and determined to make a change. I, along with some members of the Nashville Student Movement, started staging sit-ins at local diners. We tried to negotiate with the owners of one of them, but they were afraid of losing their white business. In our favor was the fact that Black Nashville residents were boycotting the downtown stores at this time. Now, this is where my strategist mind kicked in. We found some middle-aged, dignified white ladies who agreed to sit at the newly desegregated lunch counter for 3 weeks. I decided to approach the problem from the perspective that our opponents were as human as we were. It always made working out problems a lot easier. The owners served us without losing all of their white customers. Counting that as a win, we decided to create the Student Nonviolent Coordination Committee, called SNCC, for short. I'm proud to be one of the founding members. Never one to back away from a challenge. Later that year, I took on the role of chairperson of SNCC. I organized the sit-ins at their segregated lunch counters in the Nashville area, making sure the protests were nonviolent. Nonviolence was a part of our creed. Approaching the problem nonviolently brought a very effective end to practices of discrimination in restaurants in the Nashville area. The next year, I started the Freedoms Ride. These protests were directed at the Greyhound bus companies, segregated bus terminals from Washington, D.C. to Birmingham, Alabama. At first, the Freedom Rides were handled by Congress of Racial Equality. However, in 1961, on a Freedom Ride in Anniston, Alabama, the core members were viciously attacked by a mob and weren't able to finish the ride. SNCC decided to complete the protest ride from Birmingham, Alabama to Jackson, Mississippi. Things were so serious that John Siegenheiler, Assistant to United States Attorney General Robert Kennedy Jr., called me before we left Nashville. He wanted us to stop the Freedom Rides because the beatings and violence would only continue if they didn't stop. I told him we were aware of the danger involved in continuing the Freedom Rides, that we had all written our wills. From the Freedom Rides, I went on to work on as an architect, strategist for Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. on the 1963 march on Washington. Though I didn't attend the march, I was recognized. You have to remember, During this time, though, women worked as hard as men. We were still expected to stay in our place, which was not in the public. Our next major project was in 1965, voting rights campaign in Selma, Alabama. Most of us remember Bloody Sunday. It's amazing to me that in the 21st century, we still had to fight for our right to vote. Later, I moved to Chicago and went on to serve as an advocate for the Fair Housing Practices. Not that I expected to be recognized for my contributions to the civil rights movement, but I've been honored with the Rosa Parks Award, Distinguished American Award, and the LBJ Award for Leadership in the Civil Rights and the Freedom Award from the National Civil Rights Museum. It was never about the awards and recognition. It was about the call.
From my early years, it was obvious I was intelligent. I was a valedictorian. I was right. From my early years, it was obvious that I was intelligent. I was a valedictorian of my high school class, graduated from Fisk University in 1888, and I was able to join Harvard University that same year as a junior. A couple years later, I graduated and was one of the commencement speakers for my class. In 1891 and 1895, I received my Master's of Arts from Harvard University. And then I was the first African-American to receive a doctorate from Harvard University. After that, post-college, I spent a couple of years at the University of Pennsylvania as an assistant instructor in sociology. That was where I published my studies. After college, I spent a couple of years at the University of Pennsylvania as an assistant instructor in sociology. That was where I published my study, The Philadelphia Negro, a social study in 1899. After that, I left there and I went to Atlanta University, and I not only taught economics and history, but I also organized the Atlanta University Studies of the Negro Problem Conference. At Atlanta University, I also edited or co-edited a number of annual publications, including The Negro Artisan, The Negro Church, Economic Cooperation Among Negro Americans, but I am probably most known for the publication of The Soul of Black Folk in 1903. From 1934 to 1944, I was the chairman of the Department of Sociology at Atlanta University. And then in 1940, I founded FIDE, a social science quarterly. Perhaps my most significant historical work was Black Reconstruction in America, 1860 to 1880. This piece details the role of African Americans in American society, specifically during the Reconstruction period. Now, there is no doubt that you've probably heard of this disagreement. Well, more than disagreement between the esteemed Booker T. Washington and myself. Now, to be fair, Washington and I agreed on a number of things, particularly our stance on stopping the violence and lynching against Black people. The gist of our disagreement came in with the education of our people. I strongly oppose the concept that he put forward in his Atlanta Compromise that economic freedom for post-slavery African Americans should be obtained through industrial education. All right, yes, some may have a decent living, but the true measure of status in this country is through power, political and economic power. You see, yes, I meant giving our people the vote. You see, he didn't see the value in one, cultivating a strong intellectual base by educating the most intelligent African Americans who would then go to have real careers in professions like teachers, doctors, attorneys, those who could inspire the masses by getting a well-rounded liberal arts education and then get it into positions of power. You see, concentrating our education on manual or industrial training would forever relegate us to second-class citizenship. Oh, and by the way, I didn't actually originate the phrase the talented tenth. That was Henry Lyman Morehouse, the man that Morehouse College is named after. However, my use of it in The Negro Problem in 1903 popularized it. Now, on the scholarly front, I have received many honorary degrees. I'm a fellow and life member of the American Association for the Advancement of Science and I'm a member of the National Institute of Arts and Letters. To many, I am regarded as one of the outstanding African-American intellectuals of my period in America. Have you ever heard of the Niagara Movement? No. Well, it was an African-American protest group that I founded in 1905 for professionals and scholars alike. I also edited The Moon and The Horizon for the group. Later on, I was one of the co-founders of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP. I served in several capacities within the organization. I was on its board of directors, the director of publicity and research, and I founded and was the editor for its monthly magazine, The Crisis. With this magazine, I made sure that it was a source of pride and information for African Americans, and I made just as sure that it constantly agitated the status quo of the white Americans in this country. The NAACP was the leading force conducting racial protests and securing anti-lynching legislation the decades following World War I. In 1934, I resigned from the board of the NAACP and the Crisis. I had started to believe a new African American nationalist about 10 years later as the director of special research. And then I worked there until 1948 as a consultant to the United Nations for grievances of African Americans. It was about this time that I became what you might call a global citizen. In 1949, I attended the New York, Paris, and Moscow peace congresses. And then in 1950, I served as the chairman of the Peace Information Center and ran for the US Senate on the American Labor Party ticket in New York. In 1950 and 1951, I ran into a little difficulty. I was tried, but I was acquitted as an agent of a foreign power in one of the most ludicrous actions ever taken by the American government. I mean, it was ridiculous. However, I didn't allow that to stop me. I completed my quest, traveling widely throughout Russia and China in 1958 and 1959, and then in 1961, I joined the Communist Party of the United States. President Kwame Nkrumah, the first president of Ghana, requested that I move to Ghana and assume the position of director of the Encyclopedia Africana. I made the decision to leave this country in 1961 and moved to Ghana, where I became a naturalized citizen. And that's where I lived the rest of my life.
It's never a household word, though many of the people I have worked with are well known to you. I'm Bayard Rustin, a civil rights organizer and activist, best remembered for my work with Martin Luther King Jr. and others in the 1950s and 60s. So you ask, who is Bayard Rustin? Well, after moving to New York in the 1930s, I became involved with a pacifist group, an early civil rights project for protests, combining my belief in nonviolence resistance with my organizational skills. I became a key advisor to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in the 1960s. I was no stranger to social justice and discrimination. I was arrested several times for civil disobedience and for being openly homosexual. That didn't stop me. I continued to fight for equality. In my early life, let me start from the beginning, so you can understand how my foundational beliefs started me on this journey. I was born March 17th, 1912 in Westchester, Pennsylvania, Quaker country. Growing up, I was told that my parents were Julia and Jennifer Rustin, when in fact they were my grandparents. I didn't make this discovery until just before I was an adolescent. My actual mother was a woman known as my sister Florence. They said my father was a West Indian immigrant named Archie Hopkins. Well, that's all I'm going to say about that. Let's move on. I attended Wilberforce University in Ohio and Cheney State Teachers College, now Cheney University in Pennsylvania. Both were historically Black schools. In 1937, I moved to New York City and studied at the City College of New York. For for a short period of time, I got involved with a young Communist League. It was just for a quick minute. But by the 1930s, I'd gotten disillusioned with their activities and resigned. My personal philosophy has been a combination of pacifism and of the Quaker religion, the nonviolence resistance taught by Mahatma Gandhi, and the socialism espoused by African labor leader A. Philip Randolph, whom I worked for Randolph during World War II as he fought against racial discrimination in war-related hiring. I paid for my beliefs for several times. I was jailed for 2 years for failure to register for the draft. I was arrested and sentenced to work on a chain gang for several weeks. In 1947, while in North Carolina, for protesting against their segregated public transit system. They got me for a morals charge in 1953 for publicly engaging in homosexual activities. And I spent 60 days in jail. However, that didn't stop me from living my life as an openly gay man. By the 1950s, I was considered an expert organizer of human rights protests. In 1958, I played an important role in coordinating a march in Alabaster, England, where 10,000 attendees demonstrated against nuclear weapons. A. Philip Randolph orchestrated a meeting between the then young civil rights leader, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and me in 1950. I began working with King as an organizer and strategist in 1955. I was the one who taught him about Gandhi's philosophy of nonviolent resistance and advised him on the tactics of civil disobedience. I also assisted King with the bus boycott in Montgomery, Alabama in the mid-50s. However, I'm probably known for being the key figure in organizing the 1963 March on Washington, where King gave his legendary speech, "I Have a Dream," August 28, 1963. 1965, my mentor, Asa Philip Randolph, and I co-founded the A. Philip Randolph Institute, a labor organization for African-American trade union members. I knew I would always lend my time and talents to working with the civil rights and peace movements, which included many speaking engagements. I've received countless awards and honorary degrees throughout my career. In 1972, Down the Line is a collection of my writings about civil rights. It was actually published. It was followed by Strategists for Freedom in 1976. And as I considered it my life work, I continue to speak about two major issues on the importance, one, the importance of economic equality within the civil rights movement, and the other, the need for social rights for gay and lesbians. I am Black History.
Who was Shirley Chisholm? She was unbought and unbossed. And that wasn't just the title of her book. It expressed the epitome of who Shirley Chisholm was. Though she was born in Brooklyn, November 30th, 1924, to a Guyanese American father and a Barbadian American mother, growing up like many others living with discrimination and economic hardships, she spent part of her youth in Barbados with her grandmother. It was apparent, too, from a young age that Shirley, as the old folks used to say, had brains. She excelled academically. In fact, it seems she excelled in everything she put her mind to, including activism. Returning from Barbados, she attended the Girls High School in Brooklyn. then on to Brooklyn College, winning awards for her debating skills. Brooklyn College is also where her community service and civic activism bloomed. She joined Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, the Harriet Tubman Society. She pushed for more women to become student government leaders and advocated for an African-American history curriculum and many other issues. Graduating from Brooklyn College in 1946, she graduated from Columbia University's Teachers College 5 years later with a master's degree in elementary education. She became involved in politics in 1953 when she accompanied, She became involved in politics in 1953 when she campaigned for Brooklyn's first Black judge, Louis Flagg Jr., later becoming involved in the Bedford-Stuyvesant Political League, who fought for economic empowerment and civil rights. Soon after, she became active in other political groups like the League of Women Voters, the Brooklyn Democratic Club, and the Unity Democratic Club. Drawing on the experience she gained working with those groups, she ran a successful bid for the New York State Assembly in 1964. She served there from 1965 to 1968. She worked tirelessly for her community, including getting domestic workers unemployed benefits, working for a program that provided underprivileged students the opportunity to attend college while taking remedial education classes, programs that youth still benefit from today. In 1968, Shirley became the first African-American woman elected to the United States House of Representatives, serving from 1969 to 1983. Wow. The first woman. That was only 54 years ago. And she didn't just hold a seat, she worked on a number of important committees, like the House Agricultural Committee. She worked to keep food safe and affordable. Well, is what they were supposed to do, and maintain the quality of life in rural areas and ensure the competitiveness of American agriculture. She worked on the Veterans Affairs Committee. They do everything concerning United States veterans, review current legislation, makes recommendations for new bills or amendments concerning veterans. Also, things about those veterans' retirement and disability pensions, life insurance, and all that other stuff. She worked on the Education and Labor Committee. They have jurisdiction over labor initiatives aimed at strengthening healthcare, job training, and retirement security for workers, including anti-poverty programs. She worked on the Rules Committee. It is in charge of determining under what rules bills can come to the floor. It is referred to as the traffic cop of Congress. But where she really left her mark was in 1972, when she became the first African-American woman to run for the President of the United States from a major political party, and the first woman of any race who could legally hold the office. Her campaign brought the issues of race and gender equality to the forefront of the nation. She accomplished so much in her 80 years. In fact, you need to check the information out for yourself. Check out information on her life, really.
Okay, there you go. There you go. Where's the recording? Let me.
She became involved in politics in 1953. When she campaigned for Brooklyn's first Black judge, Louis Flagg Jr., later becoming involved in the Bedford-Stuyvesant Political League, who fought for economic empowerment and civil rights. Soon after, she became active in other political groups like the League of Women Voters, the Brooklyn Democratic Club, and the Unity Democratic Club. Drawing on the experience she gained working with those groups, she ran a successful bid for the New York State Assembly in 1964. She served there from 1965 to 1968. She worked tirelessly for her community, including getting domestic workers unemployed benefits, working for a program that provided underprivileged students the opportunity to attend college while taking remedial education classes, programs that youth still benefit from today. In 1968, Shirley became the first African-American woman elected to the United States House of Representatives, serving from 1969 to 1983. Wow. The first woman. That was only 54 years ago. And she didn't just hold a seat, she worked on a number of important committees, like the House Agricultural Committee. She worked to keep food safe and affordable. Well, is what they were supposed to do, and maintain the quality of life in rural areas and ensure the competitiveness of American agriculture. She worked on the Veterans Affairs Committee. They do everything concerning United States veterans, review current legislation, makes recommendations for new bills or amendments concerning veterans. Also, things about those veterans' retirement and disability pensions, life insurance, and all that other stuff. She worked on the Education and Labor Committee. They have jurisdiction over labor initiatives aimed at strengthening healthcare, job training, and retirement security for workers, including anti-poverty programs. She worked on the Rules Committee. It is in charge of determining under what rules bills can come to the floor. It is referred to as the traffic cop of Congress. But where she really left her mark was in 1972, when she became the first African-American woman to run for the President of the United States from a major political party, and the first woman of any race who could legally hold the office. Her campaign brought the issues of race and gender equality to the forefront of the nation. She accomplished so much in her 80 years. In fact, you need to check the information out for yourself. Check out information on her life, really.
My name is William Hasty, and I was born in Knoxville, Tennessee in 1904. I know, that was a long time ago, a really long time ago. And you may not know about me, although I do have a spot in Black history. My life wasn't as hard as a lot of Negroes during that time. While the majority of Negroes during that time were not formally educated, both of my parents had college degrees. My father, William H. Hasty Sr., worked for the government, and my mother, Roberta, was a school teacher. When I turned 12, my father was transferred to the U.S. Pensions Agency in Washington, D.C., so our family moved to D.C. I was a fairly good student. I graduated from Dunbar High School in D.C. when I was 16 and went to Amherst University in Massachusetts. I got a postgraduate offer from Oxford University and from the University of Paris. But I decided to accept a faculty job at Bordertown Manual School in New Jersey. Now, I stayed there until I entered Harvard University Law School in 1927. Now, I joined the Harvard University faculty in 1930, the Howard University faculty in 1930, and went back to Harvard for my JD degree in 1933. Now, I became one of the first Blacks to work in the Franklin D. Roosevelt administration. I was appointed his race relationships advisor. Seems like we still need a few of those. Anyway, later I was given the job of assistant solicitor for the Department of the Interior. Now, during my time with the Department of the Interior, I drafted a constitution for the Virgin Islands. It drew the attention of President Franklin D. Roosevelt. And in 1937, he appointed me judge of the Federal District Court for the Virgin Islands. Now, most reports say I was the first Black federal judge. A Black man in that high a position in the 30s? You want to talk about a drop in public opinion polls? That brought a lot of public criticism and controversy. And I don't mean just from people in the segregated South. I wasn't there long, about 2 years. I resigned to become the dean of the Howard University School of Law, as well as a faculty member. Now, one of my students was the future Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall, who led the legal defense fund for the NAACP. In fact, Thurgood and I served as co-lead lawyers on a landmark voting rights case where the Supreme Court overturned a Texas law. The case was called Smith v. Allwright. Now, there was talk of me being nominated for the Supreme Court, but it didn't happen. As long as one of us made it, it was okay. Really. A lot of things were happening for me around that time. While serving as the civilian aide to the Secretary of War, Henry L. Stimson, from 1940 to 1942, I had another life-changing event. I married the love of my life, Beryl Lockhart, in 1942. She was from the Virgin Islands. Now, there was a little bit of an age difference, 15 years, but for us, it worked. We had two children, my son, William Jr., and my daughter, Karen, both lawyers. Anyway, while working for the Secretary of War, I constantly pushed for the integration of our troops. Now, when the Army and Air Force decided to create a separate training facility for Blacks, I resigned and returned to my duties at the Howard University School of Law. Now, it seems that all of my protesting wasn't in vain. After I left, the Army and the Navy began limited experimentations with integrated units. Now, it seems I wasn't through making history, or maybe history wasn't through making me. Now, in 1946, President Harry Truman appointed me the governor of the Virgin Islands, making me the first appointed Black to hold the post of governor of a United States territory. 3 years later, President Truman nominated me for the judge of the 3rd United States Circuit Court of Appeals. I was confirmed by the Senate in 1950. At that time, it was the highest position held by a Black person. Well, I retired from that position in 1971. After my retirement, I became an activist for Black causes and a lawyer for public interest groups until my time was up in 1976. I appreciate you spending this time letting me reminisce. Ours is a rich and fertile history. Continue to tell our stories.
In the age of the internet, with Google and all, and news being consumed in micro bits and at lightning speed, the reading of a good old-fashioned newspaper is almost obsolete. But back at the beginning of my career, putting out newspapers, especially Black newspapers, were our community's lifeblood. Robert Singstack Abbott. That's a mouthful, isn't it? My name may not mean much to folks today, but in 1905, I founded one of the first, and without contradictions, one of the most influential Black newspapers in the country, the Chicago Defender. Without me, there might not have been an Ebony, Jet, Essence, or even Black Enterprise magazines. For over three decades, it was the most widely published Black newspaper. We waged war against segregation, discrimination, and all other types of alienation that impacted Blacks. The Chicago Defender was started with a quarter as a four-page folded pamphlet. And once a week, I was a one-man show pushing that paper through the Black neighborhoods. I was born in 1870, just 5 years after the Civil War ended, on St. Simon's Island in Georgia. My parents, Thomas and Flora Abbott, were former slaves and continued to work on the Stevenson plantation for a while. My father died when I was young, and there was some kind of custody battle between his family and my mother. So she took me and went back to Savannah to be near her family. That's where she met John Saintstack, a missionary and publisher. He was half Black and half German. He helped her with the custody case, and they later married, having 6 more children. His is an amazing story, but that's for another time. Now, unlike my stepfather and siblings, I was truly a dark-skinned brother. I experienced the full force of segregation and racism. It was the Jim Crow South, but for colorism, which was prominent as well. Yeah, I got hit from the white side and the Black side. At 16, to prepare for college, I attended the Beach Institute in Savannah, which was a missionary school. That was hard. Not the curricula, but the students. I was one of 2 or 3 dark-skinned students there, and we really caught it from the light-skinned students. It was so rough that I begged my stepfather to get me out of there, and he did. And I went to Claflin University in Orangeburg, South Carolina. While at Claflin, I decided to apply to Hampton Institute to learn the printing trade. I had worked in printing with my stepfather before, and while I waited to get into Hampton, I worked as an apprentice for the Savannah Echo. Now, don't think life was a dream at Hampton. I still experienced colorism there. However, I found I had an in one area. I had a nice singing voice and was the first year student ever selected to sing with the Hampton Quartet. But later, I heard it was because the school liked to send dark-skinned students on fundraising missions. I decided to dig in and study, finishing my printing courses in 1893 and my academics in 1896. I worked as a printer and school teacher at my stepfather's paper in Woodville, just outside of Savannah. But after a broken heart, I moved to Chicago and applied to Kent College for a law degree. It hurt my stepfather to his heart when I registered as Robert Saintstack Abbott, adding my biological father's last name. I graduated with a law degree in 1899. I was the only African-American in my class. Edward Morris, a well-known light-skinned lawyer and politician, told me that as dark as I was, it would be hard for me to get work. Black lawyers in Chicago area only got part-time work at best. I left Chicago to try to find work in Topeka, Kansas, and Gary, Indiana, to no avail. So I returned to Chicago. I gave up practicing law. I didn't even take the bar. I went back to the printing business. Thing was, I had gotten a union card earlier with the understanding that it was only supposed to be good for that day. However, a local politician named Lewis Anderson found out that I had the card and made a printing house doing work for the city hire me. I had steady work for a while. My stepfather died in 1904, and my sister and I were going to start a new school, but I changed my mind and stayed in Chicago. Printing was in my blood. And even though Chicago already had 3 Black newspapers that were barely making it, in May of 1905, I started the Chicago Defender. I went around distributing it myself. And in 1912 before it got a place on the newsstands. Man, I tell you, I worked my butt off selling that paper to Black people. I went to every gathering place and social event in the community, getting news, trying to get advertising. I continued even after I could hire people to do it for me. That way, I could stay on top of what was happening in the community. I put everything I had into that paper, but it still almost folded within 3 months. I believe the only reason it survived was because of my landlady, Henrietta Lee. she had taken a maternal liking to me, and she believed in the same, we believed in the same causes. So she let me use the dining room of her second floor apartment at 3159 State Street as the newspaper's office. I couldn't hire staff. I couldn't even pay myself. But people from all over, from other parts of the country, would contribute stories and news items to us. That was the headquarters of the Chicago Defender for the next 15 years. Eventually, it took over the whole building. The newspaper slowly grew until we had over 1,000 subscriptions. We were thriving. In 1918, I bought Miss Lee an 8-room brick house. When she moved into the new home, I followed her there as a lodger. Her family became helpful as well. Later, her daughter became one of my longtime employees, and her son was a stockholder in the company. See, because of our tenacious stand against racism and injustice, and our encouraging Blacks to come to the North, the Defender was banned in the South. It became dangerous to distribute the Defender in the South. We worked out a system. Ever hear of A. Philip Randolph or the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters? Well, before they were formally organized, the Black porters were the pipeline to getting the copies of the Defender to the Blacks in the South. Our setup was like the way that the Underground Railroad worked. We had got copies of the paper to the porters, who would hide them, and then at predetermined points, they would throw them off the train to our contacts in the South to pick them up and distribute them all around the South. We couldn't have done it without them. Now, I'm not boasting when I say that the Chicago Defender and I became a major part in helping huge number of Southern Blacks escape the horrors of the Jim Crow South across the Mason-Dixon line to the North. Man, I used that paper to really promote Chicago as a promised land. Jobs, beauty products, tech devices, restaurants, nightclubs, sports. We were the first Black newspaper to have a full entertainment section. We were courting Southern Blacks in the spring of 1917. We even had a Great Northern Day. That was during the Great Migration. By 1940, 1.5 million Black people had moved north. By 1970, another 5 million made their way across the Mason-Dixon line to the North, Midwest, and West. About 100,000 of them came to Chicago. We helped them take advantage of the new economic opportunities in the North around World War I. Now, there have been hiccups, ups and downs in my life. 2 marriages, 2 divorces. Staffing and financial issues, but there is no denying that I was a smart businessman. I knew how to recognize, communicate the needs, concerns, and opinions of the Black communities. Decades after its inception, the Defender has adapted to all the changes and is still standing.
Arturo Alfonso Schomburg, born January 24, 1874, was a historian, writer, collector, and activist. He was a Puerto Rican of African and German descent. He moved to the United States in 1891, where he researched and raised awareness for the great contributions that African Americans and Afro-Latin Americans made to society. Arturo Alfonso Schomburg was born in the town of Santurce in Puerto Rico. He was born to Mary Joseph, a freeborn Black midwife from St. Croix, and Carlos Federico Schomburg, who was a merchant son of a German immigrant. In grade school, one of his teachers told him that Black people had no history, no heroes, and no accomplishments. He was determined to prove his teacher wrong. He began the search for documentation of the accomplishments of those born of the African diaspora. This included individuals from the continent of Africa as well as throughout the world. He was trained in commercial printing at San Juan Instituto Popular. Then he attended St. Thomas College, where he studied Negro literature. He moved to a Puerto Rican community in the Cuban district of Harlem. This place was known for his nationalist intellectuals and politically radical workers. Having experienced racial discrimination in the United States, he started calling himself Afro-Puerto Rican. Schomburg became an active supporter of the liberation of Cuba and Puerto Rico from Spain. In 1892, Schomburg co-founded the Las Dos Antillas, also known as the Two Islands. This was a political club advocated for the independence of Cuba and Puerto Rico. It existed from 1892 to 1898. Their members discussed the provision of weapons, medical supplies, and financial aid for independence movements. Arturo was a true family man. In 1895, he married Elizabeth Hatcher of Virginia. She moved to New York as part of the Great Northern Migration. They had three sons, Maximo Gomez. He was named after the Dominican military leader who fought for Cuban independence. Arthur Alfonso Jr. and Kingsley Guarionez Schomburg. His middle name is derived from the renowned Taino indigenous leader. Unfortunately, she died 5 years later. In 1902, Schomburg married for a second time. This time it was to Elizabeth Morrow Taylor of North Carolina. She passed away in 1938. They had two sons, Reginald Stanton and Nathaniel Jose Schomburg. Marrying for the third and last time, he wed Elizabeth Green, with whom he had three more children. He seemed to have an attraction to the name Elizabeth. Schomburg worked various jobs to support his family, but he never ended his quest of documenting the history and contributions of the African diaspora. Schomburg started writing about African American and Caribbean history. His first known article is Haiti Decadent, was published in 1904 in the Unique Advertiser. In 1909, he wrote Placido, a Cuban Martyr, a short pamphlet about the poet and independence fighter Gabriel de la Concepcion Valdez. In 1911, Schomburg co-founded the Negro Society for Historical Research with John Edward Bruce. The mission was to help support their scholarly efforts. For the first time, it brought together West Indian, African, and Afro-American scholars. In 1914, Schomburg joined the American Negro Academy, becoming the fifth and last president. He held office between 1920 through 1928. Founded in Washington, D.C. in 1897, the Academy was the first major African-American learned society that brought together scholars, editors, activists to refute racist scholarship. It also promoted Black claims to individual, social, and political equality. It published the History and Sociology of African-American Life. In 1915, Dr. Carter G. Woodson co-founded the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History, now called the Association for the Study of African-American Life and History, and began publishing the Journal of Negro History. Schomburg was involved in the Harlem Renaissance movement, which spread to other African-American communities in the United States. The concentration of Blacks in Harlem from across the United States and the Caribbean led to a flowering of arts, as well as intellectual and political movements. He was the co-editor of the 1912 edition of Daniel Alexander Payne Murray's Encyclopedia of the Colored Race. In 1916, Schomburg published the first notable bibliography of African-American poetry, a bibliographical checklist of American Negro poetry. In March 1925, he published his essay, The Negro Digs Up His Past, in an issue of Survey Graphic, which was devoted to the intellectual life of Harlem. It had widespread distribution and influence. The noted audiodect historian John Henry Clark once said that he was so inspired by the essay that he left his home in Columbus, Georgia at the age of 17 to speak to Mr. Schomburg and further his studies in African history. Alan Locke included the essay in his edited collection, The New Negro. Schomburg's extensive collection of literature, art, and other materials was purchased in 1926 by the NYPL and Ernestine Rose, who was the librarian of the 135th Street Branch. They appointed Schomburg as curator of the Schomburg Collection of Negro Literature and Art. This collection was named in his honor at the Harlem 135th Street Branch of the library. It was later renamed the Arthur Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture. His expertise was widely acknowledged. In 1931, he became the curator of Negro Collection at Fisk University Library in Nashville. His expertise was widely acknowledged. In 1931, he became the curator of Negro Collection at the Fisk University Library in Nashville, Tennessee. He directed their acquisition of materials. During 1932, he traveled to Cuba and met various Cuban artists and writers and even acquired more material for his studies. Following a dental surgery, Schomburg became ill and died June 10, 1938 in Madison Park Hospital located in Brooklyn in New York. He is buried in the Locust Grove section of Cypress Hill Cemetery. Though he is gone, his legacy lives. Through his amassed collection of artworks, manuscripts, rare books, slave narratives, and other artifacts of Black history, he traveled to Spain, France, Germany, and England to seek out more pieces of Black history to add to the collection, even after selling it to the New York Public Library. Hampshire College awards a $30,000 merit-based scholarship in his name for students who demonstrate promise in the areas of strong academic performance and leadership at the college and in the community. The College of Arts and Sciences at the University of Buffalo also has a fellowship named in his honor. In 2020, the United States Postal Service featured Schomburg on a postage stamp as part of his series of the Harlem Renaissance. Arturo Alfonso Schomburg's work continues to serve as an inspiration to Puerto Ricans, Latinos, and Afro-Americans. There is the power of knowing about the great contributions that Afro-Americans and Afro-Latin Americans have made to society.
Marcus Mosiah Garvey. I was born on August 17th, 1887 in St. Anne's Bay, Jamaica. My parents were Marcus Garvey Sr., a stonemason, and Sarah Jane Richards, a domestic. Though my parents had 11 children, only me and one other sibling survived into adulthood. I attended school in Jamaica until I was 14. That was where I first experienced racism, mainly from my white teachers. That was when I left St. Anne's Bay for Jamaica, the nation's capital. I found a job as an apprentice in the print shop. That was where I became involved in the labor union for a print tradesman in Kingston. That set the stage for my activism later in life. I also spent time in Central America with relatives before I moved to London in 1912. I studied law and philosophy at the University of London's Birkbeck College. Education I probably would have been denied in America because of my color. I was active while in London. I worked for a Pan-Africanism newspaper, and I led debates at Speaker's Corners in Hyde Park. That's an area in the largest park in London. On Sundays, people gathered there to hear speakers or people debating on important topics. After 2 years there, I returned to Jamaica. Two important things happened after my return. One, I began corresponding with Booker T. Washington, the African-American leader, author, and activist. He was born into slavery. In 1916, I boarded a ship bound for the United States, where, as a dramatic and invigorating public speaker, I intended to go on a lecture tour. Two, I started the Universal Negro Improvement Association. It was a fraternal organization of Black nationalists. The goal of the UNIA was to obtain separate but equal status for people of the African diaspora. We wanted to establish independent Black states around the world, especially in Liberia. I was considered by many to be a noted civil rights activist and a stimulating speaker. In 1916, I planned a lecture tour in the United States. As it happened, I ended up settling down in New York City, where I first spoke at the famous St. Mark's Church. After that, I went on a 38-city speaking tour to earn a little extra money. I took on work in a print shop. This is where I wrote the Declaration of Rights of the Negro Peoples of the World. I presented it at the Universal Negro Improvement Association in 1920, where it was ratified. And I was elected the Provisional President of Africa. I founded a newspaper called the Negro World and a shipping company. Yes, a black man started a shipping company. In 1919, we had more than 4 million members by then. The Black Star Line, that's what we named it. Not long after the Black Star Line purchased its first ship, the SS Yarmouth, and rechristened it the SS Frederick Douglass. It began its African Redemption Liberia program with the idea of establishing a nation on the west coast of Africa for African Americans or those who were born into slavery or were the descendants of enslaved people. Now, don't think everybody was standing around cheering our movement and its success. Because of my outspoken activism and cry for black nationalism, I became a target of J. Edgar Hoover and what was then the Bureau of Investigation, later named the Federal Bureau of Investigation. They began investigating me on charges of mail fraud in connection with the Black Star Line. See, it included a photo of a ship before the company actually had a vessel in its fleet. There was somewhat of a silver lining, though. Hoover, who called me a notorious Negro agitator, hired the first black man FBI agent in 1919, just to spy on me. In 1923, after a controversial trial, I was found guilty of mail fraud charges, and sentenced to 5 years in prison. I had Jewish judge and Jewish jurors who sought retribution against me after I had agreed to meet with the Grand Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan, KKK, several months prior to the trial. I simply believe the KKK shares similar views on segregation. And since I wanted the separate states for African Americans, I wrote my famous paper, First Message to the Negroes of the World, from Atlanta Prison. While serving time in prison in Atlanta, I got off prison in 1928 and went to Geneva, Switzerland to speak in front of the League of Nations about race and the worldwide abuse of people of color. A few months later, I returned to Jamaica, where I established the People's Political Party, the nation's first modern political organization. Its platform focused on workers' rights and the poor. My philosophy is this: we must canonize our own saints, create our own martyrs, and elevate to positions of fame and honor black men and women who have made their distinct contributions to our racial history. I am the equal of any white man, and I want you to feel the same way.
I'm a nerd, and I've always been kind of a science buff. But I'll confess that I'm only now learning about the incredible life and legacy of Dr. Percy Julian. He's now rightly considered to be one of the greatest chemists in American history. Our people were fighting the fight long before the civil rights movement. The grandson of slaves, Percy LaVon Julian, was born in Montgomery, Alabama in 1899. He only went to school through the eighth grade because where he lived at the time, there was no high school that admitted black students. Eventually, he was able to make his way to apply to DePauw University in Greencastle, Indiana. But because he only had an eighth grade education, he had to quietly go to school at night and take high school courses in order to bring himself up to speed academically. But even with that challenge, he was able to graduate first in his class and earn Phi Beta Kappa honors. After college, he took a position as a chemistry instructor at Fisk University in Nashville, where he worked until 1923. He left to complete his master's at Harvard. However, at that time, the administration there would not allow him to continue forward to complete his PhD. So instead, he became kind of an itinerant teacher, traveling from here to there to different Black colleges as an instructor. In 1931, he did what many Black intellectuals of his time did and traveled to Europe in order to receive a warmer greeting than he might receive in his native land. He eventually completed his PhD at the University of Vienna in Austria. With his doctorate in hand, he returned to DePaul University to continue his research. And in 1935, he had the joyous occasion of marrying his sweetheart, Anna Roselle. That very same year, another incredible event occurred in his life when he was able to synthesize a chemical called physostigmine in his laboratory. It had previously only been able to be produced from its natural source, which was the Calabar bean. For the first time, because of his research, the chemical became widely available for the treatment of glaucoma. However, in spite of his success, DePaul University refused to make him a full professor because of his race. He left and was having a very difficult time finding work, even though he was a genius, because of his race. After some struggle, he was hired as a lab director at Glidden Laboratory. You know them, they make paint. While there, he invented a thing called aerofoam, which was derived from the soybean, and it was used to put out oil and gas fires. It was widely used in World War II, where it saved many, many lives. In a way, you could say he was what George Washington Carver was to peanuts, Dr. Julian was to soybeans, because he came out with a wide variety of soybean-based inventions. He found a way to extract sterols from soybean oil and synthesize both the hormones progesterone and testosterone. I won't go into what those are used for, but you can ask your doctor what testosterone and progesterone can do for you. He also was able to synthesize cortisone, which is critically and still used for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. My grandfather used to tell me about this. Unfortunately, his problems weren't over. In 1950, he purchased a new home and moved his family to Oak Park, Illinois. That house was firebombed on Thanksgiving Day. Thank God he hadn't moved in yet. But the house was firebombed again in June of 1951. Leaving the Glidden Company in 1953, he established his own company, Julian Laboratories, in 1954. He ran it for many years, and in 1961, he proved he was as much a genius of business as he was in science when he sold that company for $2.3 million, which is just under $20 million in today's money. It was a life-changing event, and it made Dr. Percy Julian one of America's first Black millionaires. He later founded the Julian Research Institute, a nonprofit organization that he ran for the rest of his life. In 1973, Dr. Percy Julian became the first Black chemist elected to the National Academy of Science. In 1990, he was elected to the National Inventors Hall of Fame for his many works. In 1999, his synthesis of physostigmine was recognized as one of the greatest inventions in the history of chemicals in America. If you'd like to learn more about him, his life was actually made into a documentary for the PBS science series Nova, which is called Forgotten Genius. He may have been forgotten then, but he will never be forgotten again.
I am Zora Neale Hurston. Of course, you know I'm not really here, but play along. I'm a writer, mostly. Now, before we get started, you need to know that I'm not some sweet-talking, prissy kind of woman. I say what I have to say. I believe if you are silent about your pain, people will kill you and tell you you like it. But that won't happen here. No, sir. Now, folks still asking about where I was born and when. You'd think they'd have more important things to worry about. Well, my birthday is January 7th. But does it really matter if I was born in Notasluga, Alabama, or Eatonville, Florida? Myself, I prefer Eatonville. See, that's where I grew up. Spent most of my happiest years there. But now to this other mess about me being 10 years older than I tell people I am. Well, first of all, it ain't nobody's business. Secondly, well, I don't need a secondly. Because like I said, I prefer Eatonville. Now it's outside Orlando. It's the oldest Black incorporated town in the United States. Did you know that? And my father, John Hurston, was one of Eatonville's first mayors. He served 3 terms. Ooh, life there was good. Until I turned 13. My mother died that year, and after that, my life became hard. So hard that I left when I was in my early teens. I joined a traveling theater group and ended up in New York doing the Harlem Renaissance. Please tell me you know about the Harlem Renaissance. Claude McKay, Langston Hughes, County Cullen, James Weldon Johnson, Ma Rainey, Alain Locke, oh, and so many others. Ooh, honey, it was a great time for Black folks. And I was a natural fit. See, I was always curious about my people in education. I finished my high school studies at Morgan College. Then I went on to Howard University. And while getting my associate's degree at Howard, I co-founded the school's newspaper, The Hilltop. Then I received a scholarship to Barnard College, graduated from there with a BA degree in anthropology, and did some graduate work in anthropology at Columbia University. Now, that was when I met Langston County and Arlene. I knew all of them. In fact, Langston and I collaborated on a play called Mule Bone. Now, it's true. A few other northern cities were experiencing Black cultural explosions, but none of them like Harlem. Mm-mm. See, a lot of mainstream, that means white folks, didn't get what was really happening. So for most of my career, my popularity, such as it was in the Black community, not the Times. See, they didn't understand what I was writing about or why, but that was okay too. I wasn't writing for them. I was writing for my people, Black people, our culture, our stories. See, I didn't just love our culture. I lived it, celebrated it. Folklore. I went way south, the rural south, to study those stories. They call it anthropology. But this story is about our culture. I even traveled to Jamaica and Haiti to study the religions of the African diaspora. And yes, it included voodoo. Money? Wasn't any real money coming in for my writing. Sometimes I didn't even get paid. And as for my personal life as an adult, I was married twice, neither one for long, and I never had any children. Now see, that might have been a blessing. I worked a variety of jobs, but I kept my finger on the pulse of our community and our culture. And I kept telling our stories. Money wasn't the only thing I lost. I lost a few relationships along the way, the least of which was Langston. My name after that was all but forgotten for many years. It happens. It happens. Word today is, though, that I was one of the most talented writers of the era. Now, see, that's funny, because toward the end, I lived in a welfare home, and almost nobody remembered my name. They had to take up a collection for my burial. Didn't even get enough for a headstone. The author, Alice Walker, found out where I was buried and got a headstone for me. I'm told she said that my writings inspired her book, The Color Purple. Guess I did plant some seeds. I told our stories in every way I could. Novels, films, short stories, and plays. My work is probably more widely known now than before. You might have heard of some of them. Their Eyes Were Watching God, Mule Bone, Every Tongue Got to Confess. Here they even made God into a movie. I spent my whole life studying, advocating, and educating others about Black folklore. And then I put a lot of what I learned and what I lived in my stories. It had to be a labor of love, because I sure didn't get rich from it. But I stand by this. We need to learn about our history, take pride in who we are, where we came from, and what we're worth.
Hang on.